So British history has taken an imperial turn in the last 20 years or so, as historians of the 19th century have realised that to understand the domestic history of Britain, you need to understand its imperial connections, its colonial connections. And that's increasingly become a global history, because sometimes it's very difficult to separate out what is an empire and what is a general impact on the world. And I suppose the sea has been rather missing from those accounts. And what this book tries to do is knit together these two established historiographical themes now, global history, imperial history, but look at the sea as the agent both of power but also of cultural diffusion as well. So in the 19th century, Britain is famously at peace between 1815, when Napoleon is defeated by Allied forces at Waterloo, and the outbreak of the First World War, centenary of which we're celebrating or marking this year. There's only one major continental war in which Britain is involved, the Crimean War, and for the rest of the time, Britain is at peace, having spent most of the 18th century fighting and then getting involved in a lot of warfare in the 20th century. The 19th century is an age of relative peace. But that doesn't mean that British power is any less important, the Navy is any less important to the maintenance of that power. So the Navy converts, if you like, from fighting battles and maintaining comparative military advantage to carrying people, carrying emigrants, carrying cultural influences, carrying exhibits, carrying newspapers. And in that way, a British world is made through the settlement colonies and other areas of British interest, but not at the point of a gun, as it had largely been in the 18th century. It's partly because not much happens that the 19th century is relatively peaceful, and the mainly male historians who have written about sea and sea power tend to concentrate on the periods when most battles are being fought and where there's most defensive technology being built up. And so that takes you to the great sea battles of the 18th century and takes you to the sort of arms race of the early 20th century. So the 19th century has kind of been left out. But I also think that we take very much for granted Britain as a sea power. We don't reflect enough on what it means to be an island whose only access to the rest of the world is via the sea. And we tend to think that all empires look the same, whether they're land empires or sea-borne empires. And of course, they don't. So there's a very particular story to tell about the 19th century British Empire. And the point of the book is that you can't tell it without looking at the sea. So if you look back in history, as you look at other sea-borne empires, from the vantage point of the early 19th century, they have largely disappeared. So the example of Venice is probably the best known, a seaborne empire, the wonder of the European world. Also, if you look at the Dutch Empire or the Spanish colonial empire, these are all empires, to a certain extent they become empires of settlement, but they start out as empires based on very strong navies and very strong mercantilist policies. So anyone looking back at history from the 19th century is going to be worried. You know, how do seaborne empires last? And part of the anxiety is that the sea is a very vulnerable place, that you can't build walls around the sea in the way in which you can build borders around countries. But also, as in the 18th century, the 19th century, the 20th century, Britain is part of a naval arms race, and there's always the concern that other countries are going to catch up. And the problem in the 19th century, they're not sure who's going to catch up first. Is it going to be the French? No. Is it going to be the Americans, which they really think it's going to be? Is it going to be the Russians? And then finally, it turns out to be the Germans, and then we're on our way to the First World War. So that anxiety, I think, never goes away. I didn't realise quite how global the spread of British involvement at sea was in the 19th century. And it was only through collaborative research and discussing with the other authors in the book that I was able to appreciate that the spread of naval influence stretches from, you know, the London docks all the way over to the far Pacific. And a very good example of that is something like the guano trade, which is this manure which is effectively farmed in Southern America and is brought up to Europe as a fertilizer, but it's using effectively forced labor. So the British are sending naval ships into the Pacific, into the Fijian Islands, and into Australia to stop the forced movement of indigenous peoples to work in the guano trade in South America, which is then feeding the agricultural fields of Europe. And here we are sitting in the early 21st century thinking that connectivity is something that has only come in the last 20 or 30 years. And there it is in the 19th century. And the British Navy is right at the heart of it. I hope it will draw people's attention back to the 19th century and to appreciate that even though there aren't the famous sea battles, you know, Trafalgar, Jutland, that we associate with the Napoleonic Wars and with the First World War, the Navy and the sea more generally are a crucial part of the Imperial story.